L3-L4 disc herniation. You heard that right. L3-L4 disc herniation. That's not an area of the spine that I normally talk about, but I have received many questions about it over the years. And recently, just this week, I received a question about L3-L4 disc herniation. So I'm going to address it today because there's enough people that are interested in this topic. And in today's episode of Ask Dr. Walter Salubro, this is episode 14, that's 2 weeks straight, 14 days straight of uploading a video that answers a question that comes in the comments under my videos. So your question and your comment can be addressed in my next episode of Ask Dr. Walter Salubro, which I'm going to upload each and every day for as long as I keep getting engagement and interest and likes in this series, and I keep uploading these videos. So you need to let me know if you like this series. Let me know in the comments below. Give me a thumbs up. Share it with your friends and family. Otherwise, there's no point putting these out there if you're not gonna watch them, okay? So these are for you. And today's question, right here, today's question, episode 14, comes from Esther. And this is what Esther says. Hello, what is your suggestion for L3-L4 disc herniation? What is the cause of that? What kind of exercises are the best for that problem? Three-part question, I'm gonna address them each in this video. So great question, Esther. Thank you for asking this question. So L3-L4 disc herniation. So that's another area of the lumbar spine, just above L4 and just above L5 and just above the sacrum. It's not the most commonly bulged area of the lumbar spine, so it's not the area that gets most common disc injuries. That's the reason why I address it the least. However, I have many, many patients that come into my office with their MRI reports that report L3-L4 disc bulge or L3-L4 disc herniation, okay? So when it comes to a cause, the causes of that, you need to understand that as a corrective care chiropractor, my premise is the same regardless of the area of injury. So there can be an L3-L4 disc herniation, there can be an L4-L5 disc bulge, an L5-S1 disc bulge or herniation. My objective is always to assess the spine, the spinal alignment, the integrity of the spine's alignment, as well as the patient's posture. So in the lumbar spine, the lumbar spine is a straight, vertical, up and down straight when you look at it from the front and the back. So there's five lumbar vertebrae stacked up one on top of each other with discs in the middle. So from the front, the alignment of the entire spine is straight, including the lumbar spine. From the side view, the lumbar spine is elliptical in shape. So it's elliptical. And most of the curve of that ellipse is in the lower lumbar spine, at L5-S1, L4-L5, and some at L3-L4. Okay, and then it begins to straighten out at L2-L3, at L1-L2 and at T12-L1 because it transitions into the thoracic spine, which is a kyphosis, okay? So that upper lumbar spine is usually a straighter area and less of a curve at L3-L4. So it's one of the reasons why it's a little bit less of a common area for disc injury, because most of the loads on the curve of the lumbar spine occur at L4-L5 and L5-S1 versus L3-L4, okay? However, if there is distortions of the spinal alignment, if there's a loss of lumbar curve, if there's a straightening of the lumbar curve, these are some causes of degeneration and wear and tear and damage to the discs, even at L3-L4, and that, of course, can cause annular tears and eventually cause disc bulge and disc herniations. So spinal misalignments and degeneration or arthritic degeneration are two of the main causes of disc bulges at L3-L4 or disc herniation at L3-L4. Another variation of a spinal misalignment is scoliosis. So scoliosis can occur in the lumbar spine, whether it's been there since childhood or adolescence, or developed later on as an adult as a de novo degenerative scoliosis, which means that the lumbar spine became scoliotic or scoliosis. And what that means is a lateral curvature of the spine with rotations. So if it occurred in adults, then that's a degenerative scoliosis, which is typically caused later on in an adult's life due to a variety of different reasons. But that can also be a cause of L3-L4 disc herniation, okay? And there could be also be instabilities in that area of the spine at L3-L4. I have patients that come in with back problems, back pain, and other issues, and we discover that they also have instabilities, whether it's a retrolisthesis, typically what I see at L3-L4, sometimes it can be an anterior listhesis. These are slippages of the vertebra, forward anterior listhesis, and backwards is retrolisthesis, or it can be a side-to-side slippage, which is called a lateralisthesis. So that's a side-to-side slippage of the vertebra. So these slippages or these instabilities, they can actually shear the disc surfaces, the end plates of the vertebral end plates are shearing the surface of the disc, causing damage, and of course can lead to annular tears and eventually disc bulges at L3, L4. So again, those are some reasons and common reasons or findings that contribute to L3, L4 disc herniation. And of course, there can be traumas, whether it's a fall on the buttocks, on the back, sports injuries, car wrecks. These kind of things can also cause damage in that area of L3, L4 as well. But more common is going to be an alignment problem or some kind of degenerative problem. Okay, next part. So I want to address some of the symptoms associated with L3, L4 disc herniation. So the nerve that comes out of that area is going to be the L3 nerve, which innervates the quadricep muscle. That's the muscle above your knee, and it causes your knee to straighten out or extend out your leg. So there can be, if there's really a lot of compression at that L3 nerve because of an L3, L4 disc herniation, then that can cause weakness in the quadricep muscle. Okay, and then in terms of symptoms, there could be pain or numbness and tingling in the lower part of the front part of the thigh, okay? So that's that can be some of the sensory symptoms that could occur with L3, L4 disc herniation, okay? And in terms of, I'll talk about exercise in a moment, but I wanna stress how important it is to get the spine analyzed, okay? Get the structure of the spine analyzed. I say this over and over and over in almost all my videos. And it's because I'm a corrective care chiropractor and that's what we do. And I've seen many, many times people come into my office because other therapies have failed them. And I'm not gonna have to name off the other types of therapies, it doesn't matter what they are, but if they're not getting an assessment of the spine, then there's, other than the identification of the spinal contributing problem to the symptoms and the condition, how are you gonna be able to correct it? You need a starting point. So the analysis of a spine on X-ray gives you a starting point, okay? Also, you want to see the alignment of the spine, not just in the lumbar area where the symptoms could be coming from, but also its correlation to the thoracic area and then the cervical area as well, from the side view and also from the front view, okay? So so it's important to get the spine analyzed, get, you know, look for a corrective care chiropractor if you need help with that. Just comment below in the comment section and I'll refer you to a directory of online corrective care chiropractors trained in chiropractic biophysics just like myself, okay? So I wanna share with you a story. I actually had a patient that came in several months ago and basically was being carried in by her spouse. She had so much back pain and she had leg pain, and she also had numbness and tingling on the anterior front part of her thigh. And we looked at her x-rays and yes, there was an alignment problem. So one of the things we did with her is we started to adjust not just the lower part of the lumbar spine, but I started to adjust that L3, L4 area with gentle chiropractic adjustments. And eventually, over the next several weeks, not only did her back pain subside, but her leg pain subside, and the numbness and tingling on the anterior front part of her thigh area also resolved as well. So chiropractic adjustments can be very, very helpful. Exercises, the same exercises that will help an L405 and an L5S1 disc injury or disc bulge will be also applicable to the upper part of the lumbar spine, the L3-L4 area. So exercises like a cat camel mobilization exercise would be great. Lumbar extension exercises, strengthening exercises like prone cross crawl, Superman, planks, just to name a few. So if you see the videos on my channel that are labeled L405 disc bulge exercises or L5S1 disc bulge exercises, you know, those are the common injuries that most people come in with their MRIs and that they know that they have. So that's why I put those keywords in those video topics. But the same type of exercises can be applicable to the L3-L4 area because it's part of the same lumbar spine area, even though it's a bit higher, okay? And then last thing I wanna say is before you ever do any of the exercises, be sure you get a proper examination assessment by either your corrective care chiropractor, primary physician, or therapist that knows your spine and assessed you. To be sure that exercises are applicable to you, okay? So I really like this question today. So thanks, Etzer, for asking that question because it kind of opens up a new topic in my channel, the L3, L4 disc area and related symptoms, causes, and exercises. So if you like this video and you like that answer or you need more clarification, just comment below. Let me know what your thoughts are. I'd like to hear your thoughts. I do try to reply to as many comments as possible. I do have also a full-time practice this. Right now is my lunch break. That's when I do these videos. I also have a full-time family, okay, with two little kids. One of them just started school yesterday for the first time. So it is hard to get to every single comment, but I do my best. And I just want you also know how much I appreciate you for following my channel. You know, we're at 95,000 subscribers. Pretty soon we'll get to 100,000. And that's not a small feat. That's been over the span of really, you know, the last 5 years or so of putting work into this channel. And the reason why I keep doing these videos is because I know it helps people, not just in my local community of Vaughan, Ontario, Canada, but across, you know, the entire globe and the world. People out there that are suffering with chronic back aches and back pains and degenerative problems and spinal conditions and are just looking for answers and solutions and to be led in the right direction. So that's what this channel is about. And welcome to this. If this is the first time, subscribe. And if you want to catch the rest of the videos of the Ask Dr. Walter series, just go right here, right there. Go there right now. And then you can catch some of the other videos in this series.